Jose invited me to come here. I thought, well, should I present on the narrow area of interest that I'm writing papers on, or perhaps extend that a bit beyond? So I made the mistake of wanting to extend it a bit beyond what I write about. And it's a mistake for two reasons. First, because I thought at this point the Trump administration would have a team in place for for the Latin American component of its policies, but no one has yet been appointed. So it's difficult to predict what's going to happen when you don't know what the lineup will be. And second, all politics is local, so the probability that Trump will get to affect U.S. historical policies towards Latin America hinges on whether Trump will be able to pass the healthcare reform. Because if that doesn't go through, then it's going to be a bit more difficult for him to have influence over other things. So with those two caveats in mind, let me move on. So I thought about Trump because this is a recent paper that just came out this week in the Journal of Latin American Studies. A colleague of mine and I were studying Salvador Allende's presidential approval in the 1970s before he was overthrown. We ran into some polls housed here at Cornell at the Roper Center, and we looked at Allende's approval and see how popular or unpopular he was before he was overthrown. And the title of our paper is based on a U.S. President Nixon's phrase. Right after Allende's victory in 1970, Nixon called on his advisors to make the economy scream. So Nixon thought, well, in order to destabilize Allende, what we're going to do is we're going to put pressure on the economy, and then Chileans will disapprove of Allende, and eventually he's going to be overthrown. Well, my presentation is not about Allende, but the last poll conducted in Chile before Allende was overthrown in February of 73 showed Allende having a 49% approval. Not bad. And the most interesting thing is that even though people thought the economy was bad, the main determinants of support for Allende were ideological, not economic vote determinants. Thus, the make the economy scream strategy didn't work out. So fast forward to Trump, and I thought, well, what will Trump do when unfriendly governments get elected in Latin America? How is he going to deal with that? And that's kind of going to be the focus of my talk today. This was supposed to be an essay that I was writing for the America's Quarterly, but they just delayed the issue because no one knows what Trump is going to do. And the issue was supposed to be about evaluating the Trump team towards Latin America, but that it's a bit difficult. So, how will U.S. Latin American relations look like in the next 4 years? Is it going to be like friendly but distant, as it was under Obama? Will the U.S. go after the left tide in Latin America? But there isn't a left tide anymore. So, just as Latin America is moving towards sort of market-friendly policies, the U.S. seems to be moving away from market-friendly policies. So that it's an interesting tension that might produce interesting results. And as it happened elsewhere in the world, but particularly in Mexico, Latin America was a bit shocked as well when Donald Trump won the presidency. That evening, I was in Chile, and I made the mistake of accepting to be on a TV program to sort of comment on the news. Chile's 2 hours ahead of New York, so we were up until like 5 a.m. in the morning when Trump, or 4 a.m. in the morning, well, it's about 4:30 a.m. in the morning when Trump spoke in Chile. The interesting thing is that the ratings were pretty good. They were like 12% rating at 4 o'clock in the morning. So people were paying attention to what was happening in the U.S., and people are paying attention as to what Trump will do. Now, let's do a little brief history of U.S.-Latin American relations to show the importance of what seems to be happening or might potentially happen as Trump might, among the many things he wants to change, might abandon the Monroe Doctrine simply by not paying attention to Latin America in ways that previous governments did. So If you recall, the Monroe Doctrine in 1823, in essence, kind of established a boundary for European countries not to have influence over Latin America. Now, of course, that was much more a declaration of intent than a reality in 1823. The Bolivarian Revolution was just coming to an end. Peru became independent in 1823. So the notion that the U.S. would exercise influence over Latin America was an declaration of what the U.S. wanted to do. After all, Spain was present in Cuba and Puerto Rico. The relationship between Brazil and Portugal wasn't fully defined. England had presence in Jamaica. So, but it was a long-term vision of the U.S. saying, well, we are going to be the influential country in the region, not European countries. Now, this is the U.S. in 1823. So in essence, what the eastern coast of the U.S. was saying is that we're going to have influence over the rest of the continent. But rather than influence, what ended up happening in the next few years is that the U.S. actually occupied parts of what used to be Latin America, right? Mexico, for the most part. So rather than the Monroe Doctrine, what we had for a good part of the early 19th century was manifest destiny. The U.S. was taking over territories rather than just having influence over the continent. This is just to remind some what used to be Mexican and how the U.S. sort of moved west and south after independence, concurrently with the Monroe Doctrine. So there is that tension there about having influence and incorporating those territories. Now, the notion of Yankee imperialism dates back to those years. Now, this is relevant because initially, the Monroe Doctrine is the idea that the U.S. will exert influence. But what actually happened for a good part of the 19th century is that the U.S. sort of occupied territory. If you fast forward, contrast that with the notion of building a wall, right? So just the idea behind the policy switch that Trump might be proposing, particularly with regards to Mexico, will be a sea change in terms of U.S. policies towards Latin America. And remember, in the Mexican-American War, the U.S. went all the way into Mexico City, right? Los Niños Héroes is perhaps a perfect example of how at the time, and for a good part of the 20th century as well, the U.S. was, or the big threat coming from the U.S. was invasion rather than walls. And that's not trivial. Then we have the Spanish-American War in 1898, or as Cubans would refer to it, the Cuban-Spanish-American War. And that highlights, again, the U.S. imperialist nature. More than influence in the Spanish-American War, the U.S. took over Cuba and it took over Puerto Rico. Cuba eventually achieved independence. Puerto Rico never achieved independence, but the U.S. was becoming more of a colonial power than a country that would exert influence over the rest of the region. And it wasn't just Cuba and Puerto Rico, it was also Haiti and the Dominican Republic, as we will see. But again, the southern borders of the U.S. Moved farther south, as it included Puerto Rico and Cuba. So rather than building walls, the U.S. was building bridges. Then we have the Panama Canal, probably the most evident case of American imperialism in the region. The U.S. invented a country, Panama. It built a canal. Panama ceded to the U.S. in perpetuity a 10-mile-wide canal zone. The canal was built. It came into operation in 1914. Eventually, the Panamanians developed a sense of national identity, and they wanted the canal back. The U.S. agreed to that under the Torrijos-Carter Treaty in the 1970s, and the U.S. gave Panama the canal back on January 1st, 2000. So it's a rather recent phenomenon, but the existence of Panama again highlights the intention of the U.S. to extend its influence well into Latin America. The U.S. and the Dominican Republic and Haiti, several invasions. This is a picture of a fortress in Santo Domingo with an American flag. I mean, the notion that the U.S. could sort of incorporate those territories as part of the U.S. Was still a very relevant and potentially viable notion in the early part of the 20th century. The Platt Amendment in the Cuban Constitution that granted the U.S. the right to intervene in Cuban affairs if Cuban interests or if American interests were at stake is also early evidence in the 20th century of the U.S. engagement in Latin America. Remember Guantanamo, the U.S. sort of had military presence in Cuba, and there is a great letter by John Quincy Adams, in fact, in the 1820s, suggesting that when the issue of slavery was dealt with, the U.S. should incorporate Cuba as part of the country. Then again, so the notion of the U.S. as extending its influence well, or more than its influence, sovereignty into Latin America was very much the dominant policy in the 20th century. Then we have the U.S. presence in Central America, something that everyone is familiar with. This is a quote attributed to Franklin Roosevelt. No one knows if Roosevelt actually said it, but it's an interesting quote that sort of perfectly, I think, highlights how the U.S. treated Central American countries and the response that provoked from Central America. That United Fruit Company poem by Pablo Neruda reflects sort of the reaction to U.S. Imperialism in the 1940s and starting in the 1930s. García Márquez discusses that as well. So it's present in the narrative of Latin American literature in the 20th century. Now, the 1929 recessions and World War II consolidated the Monroe Doctrine. This is the time when the U.S. actually began to exert unilateral influence over Latin America. Because of the war, England and Germany no longer had the presence they used to have in terms of trade with Latin America. And from the 1930s on, the U.S. was the dominant trading partner with Latin American countries. And that's sort of what happened from there until now. Or until the last 15 years or so, when China has sort of begun to emerge. And now, if Trump delivers on his policies of more nationalism and protectionism, then there's going to be a power vacuum that would end the policy of the U.S. as the dominant Monroe Doctrine, good neighbor policy type of policies towards the region. Now, history evolves, right? So after some 20 years of U.S. dominance in the region, we have the Cuban Revolution. And the Cuban Revolution is significant for a number of reasons, but perhaps the most important reason is that because Cuba brought the Cold War into Latin America, right? And it's important because Cuba is the only sort of significant Latin American country to have achieved, or Spanish-speaking country to have achieved, its independence from the U.S., not from Spain. So relations between Cuba and the U.S. were different than relations between other Latin American countries and the U.S. Thus, the Cuban Revolution is very important for Cuban-U.S. relations, but more so for U.S. Latin American relations, because it brought the Cold War to the region, and the Soviet Union, in essence, challenged the Monroe Doctrine. We now had another European or world power that wanted to have influence over the region. And from the 1960s on to 1989, the end of the Cold War, there was tension generated by what the U.S. perceived, and probably what was, a real threat in terms of growing Soviet influence in the region. And we had guerrilla revolutions or guerrilla movements all over the place. They succeeded in Nicaragua. They were close to succeeding in El Salvador. There was plenty of action in Guatemala as well. And many South American countries had their own guerrillas that were inspired by the Cuban Revolution and challenged the U.S. dominance and control over the region. And these were really bad years for Latin America, because it was kind of proxy wars fought between the Soviet Union and the U.S. in Latin American territory, with thousands of killed, of people that were killed. We probably know more about Argentina and Chile, human rights violations, because it was mostly middle-class people whose voices were heard. We pretty much have forgotten about human rights violations and killings in Central American countries, because was poor indigenous people that were killed for the most part. The country with the most victims is Guatemala, it's not Argentina, but we probably know much more about the Argentine desaparecidos than we know about Guatemala. So really bad years, and then things start to look slightly better, right? The 1990s, democracy becomes the only game in town, as Bill Clinton put it, when he met with Latin American leaders, with all democratically elected Latin American leaders in 1995 in Miami. The only country not attending was Cuba. All the other leaders in Latin America had been elected democratically. It was sort of a great time. That had actually begun earlier in the late 80s when Carlos Salinas de Gortari, the president elected in Mexico in 1988, and the U.S. president elected in 1988 as well in the U.S., started negotiating a free trade agreement, NAFTA. And that the negotiations began in the early 1990, and they ended in 1993, and NAFTA came into effect in early 1994. And from the 90s, two things happened in U.S. policy towards the region. The U.S. promoted democracy. Now, the Cold War was over, so the U.S. said, during the Cold War, we promoted regimes that were friendly to the U.S. In fact, the U.S. government, the Reagan administration, even invented the notion that there are two kinds of non-democratic regimes: authoritarian regimes that are market friendly and dictatorships that are not market friendly. They both violate human rights, but authoritarian regimes are slightly better because they are market friendly. When the Cold War ended, the US said, well, we are committed to democracy. So now that there isn't a communist threat, we're going to tell our authoritarian friends in Latin America that they should have elections. And the US became sort of a force to promote democracy in the region. After all, the US said, we are market friendly and we promote democracy. When the Soviet threat was there, we tolerated non-democratic governments that were friendly to the US. But now that there isn't a Soviet threat, democracy is the only game in town, and free trade, it's also the only game in town. So the Washington Consensus policies were about promoting free trade and promoting representative democracy. And in the early 1990s, it looked as if everything was sort of moving in the right direction. Bill Clinton was a popular president in Latin America. Countries, for the most part, were engaging with the U.S. in promoting free trade agreements. Argentina supported the first war in Iraq, and in exchange, the U.S. granted Argentines the right to enter the U.S. without visas. So there were all these positive things going on, and perhaps the most symbolic one was the North American Free Trade Agreement. Mexico was sort of moving away from Latin America, and it was tying its future to North America. The optimism was widespread, not just related to U.S. Latin American policies. Fukuyama talked about the end of history, right? There is now capitalism is the only game in town, and we shouldn't worry about anything else ever again. Now, it didn't turn out to be that way. In the late 1990s, some things began to happen, right? The most important is the election of Hugo Chavez that revitalized the Latin American left. Chavez developed a strong relationship with the Cuban dictatorship that strengthened Cuba after the special period with Chavez. Cuba sort of started growing again, and with plenty of oil money, Chavez was able to help several left-wing leaders get elected in Latin America. And there were different kinds of left-wing leaders in Latin America: soft left, hard left, you name it. Everyone wrote about the different kinds of left. Kenneth Roberts here wrote about it, but we all did. Everyone was sort of obsessed with the left, with the pink tide in Latin America. Now, that had some consequences. You can explain it away by the fact that there was a commodity boom, positive terms of trade, if we follow the CEPAL argument, and plenty of money to redistribute. All governments, right-wing governments and left-wing governments, implemented earmarked subsidies. Poverty declined from Chile to Brazil to Mexico. Even left-wing governments in Mexico distributed money because there was plenty of money to go around. But in addition to that, particularly the left-wing governments had somewhat of an anti-American discourse. And Chavez was the best symbol of that. Most Latin American countries didn't really strongly follow the Chavez anti-American leadership. Latin American countries were pro-US, particularly now that the US was pro-democracy and pro-market, so there was a set of significant developments. In fact, on September 9th, 2001, Secretary of State Colin Powell and all Latin American Secretaries of State in Lima signed a OAS, an Organization of American States, democratic charter, where they committed themselves to supporting only democratic governments in the region. And it was big news. In fact, on September 11th, 2001, Colin Powell was in Lima still, but things happened on that day that sort of shifted the focus and the attention of the US away from Latin America into the Middle East, or Iraq and Afghanistan. In fact, just a few days before September 11th, Mexican President Vicente Fox was in Washington, D.C. George Bush hosted a state dinner for Mexico. Bush, who spoke Spanish, not well, but his Spanish had the same grammar problems as his English, so he spoke Spanish fairly well. And Bush said, the most important relationship we have in the world is a relationship we have with Mexico. This is 2001, September 7th, 2001. And then September 11th came. 2 weeks later, Bush delivers a speech to Congress, and the only foreign leader in Congress that day is Tony Blair. And Bush says, well, and I want to thank Tony Blair for being here. He's the leader of the UK, America's truest friend. In just 2 weeks' time, or 3 weeks' time, Mexico went from being the most important to not even being there. And 2011 and the election of Chavez generated kind of a rift between the US and some Latin American countries, particularly in terms of free trade, right? And Chavez, in a famous speech in 2003, 2004 in Argentina, in Mar del Plata, using the Spanish acronym of the Free Trade Area of the Americas, which was supposed to come into effect in 2005, said, well, ALCA, the Spanish acronym, ALCA, ALCA, al carajo, and a very, very famous speech where he pretty much killed any hopes that there would be a free trade area of the Americas. And then Chavez's sort of democratic practices were criticized by the US, because he won democratic elections, but in ways that were not necessary, or governed in ways that were not necessarily democratic. Now, a caveat here, there was plenty of malapportionment in the Venezuelan electoral system, and thus the opposition would win more votes, but the government would win more seats. And the US would say, well, that shouldn't be the case, or many people in the US would say that shouldn't be the case, but then if you look at U.S. House elections, exactly the same thing happened in the U.S. So you can quite criticize Venezuela for gerrymandering when the U.S. is exactly doing the same. Sure, in Venezuela it was a central government, in the U.S. it was the state legislatures, but there is plenty of gerrymandering as well. And at the time the U.S. would criticize Chavez because Chavez would pick up fights with the press, because he would... there wasn't Twitter at the time, but he would have a TV show that lasted for many hours, and he would just go on and on and on, improvising criticisms against the press. And at the time, those leaders that were committed to democracy said, well, but that's not really democratic. Leaders shouldn't be doing that. You know, they should not mess with the press. And the U.S. was among the countries that would be leading the charge against Chavez, Evo Morales, and... certainly Cuba, but also the Kirchners in Argentina. Now, fast forward, all those things that we used to criticize about those left-wing leaders are things that now the U.S. president does all the time, right? So it's kind of difficult to criticize those things. Rafael Correa would pick fights with individual people and tweet against them. I don't know if you've ever watched a John Oliver... you know, that Last Week Tonight in HBO, a couple of years ago, he picked a fight. He criticized Correa for what Oliver considers sort of unacceptable behavior for a president, Correa would just go on Twitter against some opponents, and he would speak about them in his on his press interviews. But if you watch that now, it would be sort of, it would perfectly apply to Donald Trump. So what I'm saying there is that what the U.S. considers sort of as priorities and what the U.S. criticized among these left-wing leaders are practices that are now very common in, or at least in the first 2 months in office, are very common for the U.S. president. So September 11 brought an end to an era of sort of fast-moving free trade agreements and promotion for democracy, or consensus in terms of democratic promotion in Latin America. Now, some progress was made after 2001. The free trade area of the Americas failed. It never came into existence, but the US did sign free trade agreements with Central American countries, Panama and the Dominican Republic, with Peru, with Chile. So there was, particularly on the Pacific side of the continent, significant progress in terms of advancing that agenda of democracy and free trade, whereas on the Atlantic side, there was more reaction against the U.S. And under Chavez's sort of ideal notion of the world, you would have ALBA, the Bolivarian countries, against those countries that were more supportive of the U.S. But things did move forward. Even relations with Cuba began to normalize at the end of the Obama administration. For people who are older and who have looked at Latin America for a long time, this was almost a miracle. In fact, I don't know what the history of the Center for Latin American Studies is here at Cornell, but at Columbia, NYU, Chicago, all the Center for Latin American Studies were created right after, or a couple of years after, the Cuban Revolution, because, you know, there was a rift between the U.S. and Cuba. Now, this picture sort of brought an end to the only lasting sort of negative legacy of the Cold War, and this is just 2015, right? So early 2016, right? And then enter Donald Trump. So when things were sort of becoming normal, the US elected a president whose message challenges two central US policies towards Latin America: free trade. Trump is protectionist. The U.S. has promoted free trade in Latin America over the past 27 years since the end of the Cold War. And Trump also wants to sort of redraw the world order, right? He wants to sort of renegotiate NAFTA, renegotiate NATO, weaken the European Union, perhaps strengthen Russia. We don't quite know, but we do know that he has some plans to redefine the new world order. And assuming he gets reelected, it's going to be 8 years of a redefinition. Now, and the wall, of course, which is really a wall against, or technically a wall against illegal immigrants, against the bad hombres, as he put it. But it's also a wall that will create or will redefine relationships with Mexico and with the rest of Latin America. We don't know what's going to happen to the wall, whether it will ever be built, but it is a challenge to the Monroe Doctrine. It's like, we don't want to have influence over the rest of the region. In fact, what we want to do now is build a wall, not invade the rest of the region, but keep the rest of the region away from what we do. Now, this is happening when Latin American countries are going through a process of their own and they lack strong leadership. For many years, Fidel Castro was a strong Latin American leader, for the good or bad, but he was a well-respected, well-known, he was heard, he was influential. He retired in 2008 and started to become less and less influential. He finally died, and his brother Raul is obviously not a leader that can rise to the position that Fidel Castro had. Brazil had significant and very influential leaders from 1995 for 16 years. Under Cardoso and Lula, Brazil's leaders were very important. Even Hugo Chavez was very influential. People paid attention to what he had to say. In different dimensions, Mujica, Lagos, Bachelet, at different points, were influential. But now, no Latin American leader has sufficient international clout to speak or represent Latin America with a strong voice. Dilma Rousseff wasn't Lula or Cardoso, and Temer won't even try to have an international voice. Mexico bet on North America and Central America rather than Latin America since NAFTA, and now it must regain influence in South America now that the U.S. sort of is pushing Mexico away from North America into Latin America. And Peña Nieto is a weak leader, and he will be replaced by a new president who will be elected in July next year. One could think that Juan Manuel Santos could have risen to the occasion in Colombia. He won the Nobel Prize. He brought peace to Colombia, so everything looked great for Juan Manuel Santos, but he's now involved in the Odebrecht campaign finance scandal. He apologized for it. He's on his way out next year, but he just doesn't have the clout. He lost the political influence he had because of the campaign scandal. Odebrecht and OAS, the two Brazilian construction companies, have tainted the reputation of almost everyone in Latin America. And those who are not there yet will probably soon be, because they paid for everyone everywhere. Mauricio Macri could be the one, but he first needs to turn Argentina's economy around. Argentina's in a recession caused by Macri's policies to transform the economy. But it's difficult to be an international leader if you don't have your own house in order. And elsewhere in Latin America, Maduro's not Chavez, not even for the left wing in Venezuela. Pedro Pablo Kuczynski could have done it, but he's 78 years old and he's not doing well. His honeymoon has ended, although he's probably the closest to being a regional leader in this year. And Bachelet in Chile is on her way out. Correa is on his way out. Evo Morales is trying to find a way to stay in power. He's going to resign at the end of this year to run again in 2019 to bypass the term limits, right? There are term limits, but if he resigns, he's going to run not as a president, but as not a president, and thus he wants the constitution to be interpreted as if he's just running for the first time. Tabaré Vázquez is in his late 70s, and he's not Mujica either. Central American countries have problems of their own, and Raúl Castro is not a leader. So we don't have a regional leader. Now, if the rules for the new world are now written under or rewritten under Trump, Latin America will have no unifying voice or an influential leader who can rise to the occasion. And that's going to be a complication. Brazil and Mexico are not in a position to lead. Argentina, Colombia, and Venezuela have problems of their own, and the other countries are just too small. With all due respect, no one is going to pay attention to the Paraguayan leader because it's Paraguay, right? For now, right? And he's trying to change the constitution to stay on in the elections to be held next year. So, following the logic of the Monroe Doctrine that Trump wants to disregard, the U.S. will speak for the hemisphere. So when the countries of the world sit down to rewrite the rules, then the spokesperson for the hemisphere, for all the countries in Latin America, is going to be Donald Trump, which is quite amusing or concerning. Now, let's put Latin America in context, right? These are the main commodities that South American countries export. This is what Latin American countries look like to the world economy. Now, if you look at Latin American countries in terms of their size, Brazil is Google, Mexico is IBM, Chile is Costco, and this is from 2014. If you look at the countries by their GDP size, Brazil is California, so it's cool, Colombia is Washington, Uruguay is North Dakota. And then there are a few others there. So Latin American countries are in relative terms, not that important in the world, and thus for the rest of the world, it will make sense that Trump speaks for the whole continent. Of course, the history of Latin America is a history of ups and downs, you know, the commodity boom, when the commodities are doing well, all Latin American countries grow, the left gets to redistribute. When the commodities decline, as it has happened in the past 2 years, every country in Latin America goes into or takes a dive, and there are crises, recessions, political instability, so on and so forth. So the history of Latin America, and we've known this for the past 200 years, is a history of ups and downs, right? So a few years ago, 2008, 2009, everyone looked as if Latin America was sort of finally taking off. The region was doing great, and everyone was celebrating the miracles in Latin American countries. And then the good years are followed by bad things. Notice here, Lula wasn't that amused with Temer when... they won in 2014. And this, I guess, is the best example of the economic cycles in Latin America, right? Everyone celebrates Brazil, and now Brazil is in a state of despair. The only thing they had going for them was that they were still exporting meat, but that also went bad earlier this week. So the super cycle of commodities makes Latin American countries suffer in the bad years when the world economy takes a dive, in the good years, everyone, every economist will tell Latin American countries, in these good years, you have to save for a rainy day, create a sovereign wealth fund, because eventually the economy is going to go down and you're going to have many more needs. So years of fat cows, and in the years of fat cows, you should provide for the years of skinny cows, for a rainy day. But politically, that's very difficult, right? Because in a good year, you tell the president of Brazil, now you have to save for the bad years. And the people in Brazil will say, what do you mean a rainy day? It hasn't stopped raining on us forever. Moreover, even if you think in terms of investment, do you want to put money away in a sovereign wealth fund, or do you want to build more schools and feed children? Your return is going to be way higher if you build schools and feed children than if you put money on a sovereign wealth fund. So the problem of inequality in Latin America makes it very difficult for countries to save in the good years for what they know will happen in the bad years. So Argentina, I guess, is the example of ups and downs in Latin America. And that's why people who write about Latin America have a very pessimistic view, even in the good years, about what will happen in the region. These are some of the most successful books in Amazon on Latin America. So as you can see, I mean, the titles are just horrible. My favorite is Leftovers, about what the left is in the Latin America, or at least 2008.
Just for your information, I know Michael very well. So he wrote a book and published a book about Brazil at the same time than his. But in mine, he was In Search of the Brazil Dream.
Okay.
So his book, as I told him, sold in mine. And then I wanted to add later on something else related to Brazil.
Sure.
Yeah.
And no, Michael writes for The Economist, right?
Yeah.
He's now living in Peru. All right. Okay, and now we go to Trump. And I will end with a few slides speculating what might happen. So Trump hasn't really spoken that much about Latin America. He has referred to the wall and to the bad hombres, but he hasn't really spoken a lot about Latin America. So far, he doesn't seem to share the pro-embargo positions on Cuba. That's significant. He hasn't reversed that, and he could have. So that's significant. So he seems to be interested in promoting more trade with Cuba, and that goes against what he has spoken about protectionism. To a large extent, that is because the states that most benefit from trade with Cuba are the southern states, where he has strong support. He's opposed to free trade agreements in principle, but has not singled out any Latin American country other than Mexico when criticizing free trade agreements. So there is a contradiction there as to what he says and what he's actually doing now. There is now only one country in Latin America where people do not need visas to come to the US, and that's Chile. And when Trump got elected, everyone sort of feared that they would now have to go to the embassy to get a visa, but so far, nothing has happened. And to a large extent, so far nothing has happened is because he hasn't appointed anyone. Now, he met with Pedro Pablo Kuczynski a couple of months ago. Kuczynski came to Princeton to receive an award, and he told Kuczynski that Latin America is a good dog sleeping. So no need to wake him. No, he said that in English. Latin America is a good dog sleeping. The translation that they did in Peru and many other countries was a horrible translation. It's like Latin America is sort of a lap dog, which is it's just a good dog sleeping. No need to wake him up. That's and actually PPK made that comment when after he met with Trump and he wasn't. The White House did not comment on that, but that's sort of the perception Trump has about Latin America. Now, in general, the policies that Trump seems to have embraced should be negative towards Latin America, right? He has protectionist views, and free trade has been the basic tenet of U.S.-Latin American relations over the past 20 years. Now, trade openness is a central component of the Washington consensus, and now it seems that Washington is abandoning the Washington consensus. So his promises would represent a radical reversal from the U.S. policies towards Latin America that have dominated in the 1990s. So if Hugo Chavez said alca, alca, al carajo, it seems that now Trump is saying al carajo, right? The promotion of democracy doesn't seem to be a priority anymore, right? If you think about how Trump deals with non-democratic countries and the friends he has around, particularly Russia, it doesn't seem that he's that concerned with the promotion of democracy, respect for a free press, not getting involved in fighting with the judiciary, all those kind of things that were tenets of U.S. policies towards Latin America are kind of abandoned, at least by the practices that Trump has shown during the first 2 months in office. Not surprising, the government that is happiest about the Trump election is the Venezuelan government. This is much easier to do the type of things that they do in Venezuela when you have a Trump as president of the U.S. than when you have an Obama. In fact, if Trump criticizes Maduro, Maduro's approval goes up, because probably the only person less popular than Maduro in Venezuela is Trump. Now, how will that affect Latin America? Well, unfortunately, Latin America is now beginning a two-year crowded election cycle. There is a runoff presidential election on April 2nd. The recent polls tell us that Lenin Moreno, Rafael Correa's candidate, is ahead. All the polls are telling us that he's ahead. Polls have made mistakes, but they didn't. They got the first round vote right in Ecuador. There's only 10 days left, less than 10 days left before the election. There will be a presidential debate next week, and the election is still close enough that anything might happen. There will be midterm elections in Argentina in October, presidential elections in Chile in November, presidential elections in Honduras in November, and Honduras has now allowed for presidents to seek immediate re-election. A president was overthrown in 2009 because he wanted to establish or abolish term limits, and now they implemented that, and the U.S. has been numb quiet about what position it has on what they did in Honduras. And there are regional elections in Venezuela which might turn into presidential elections if the OAS gets its way. And then there will be presidential elections next year in Colombia, Mexico, Brazil, and Paraguay. So if you think about it, all the major countries in Latin America will have elections in the next few years, and we should expect to see a U.S. view on what is happening, but the U.S. is not really doing that much. Now, will China challenge the Monroe Doctrine and fill the power vacuum in Latin America? There are some indications that point to that trade increase up to 2013. It has leveled off since then with China, but China is a more important trade partner for all Latin American countries except Mexico. Now, still, Latin Americans have favorable views about the U.S. The U.S. is least popular in Venezuela and Argentina. But almost every country is least popular in Argentina. Argentines don't like anyone. But elsewhere in Latin America, the U.S. Remain popular. This is late 2015. The 2016 poll has not yet come out, and things have changed ever since late 2016, right? But up to 2015, the popularity of the U.S. in Latin American countries was pretty good and pretty stable. Even in Argentina, it had increased somewhat from the early years in the decade. So with the exception of Venezuela and Argentina, views of the U.S. are positive. These are Latin American countries, positive views, and as you can see, views of the U.S. are in line with views of the U.S. in Europe and Africa. The U.S. is, of course, far less popular in the Middle East, except Israel, but Latin American countries are countries where the U.S. or people like the U.S. A colleague of mine at NYU, Jorge Castañeda, who was the Mexican Foreign Affairs Minister, likes to say that the U.S. should be thankful that it has Mexico as its southern neighbor and not Pakistan, right? Because Mexicans don't blow themselves up against the U.S. That's him saying those things. He likes to provoke people. So the U.S. is popular in Latin America, but China is also popular in Latin America. People don't know China that much, but you know they trade with China, and the views of China and Latin America, in some cases, Argentina, are even better than the views the U.S. has. Now, Mexico is more pro-U.S. than pro-China, not surprisingly. So China might feel a vacuum in some countries, but not in all the countries. Now, and I'm about to end here, but what has happened so far? Well, not much, and that's the bad thing. So I set up the problem, but we don't have enough data to analyze what Trump will do. Trump has repeated the assertion that he will build a wall. The U.S. withdrew from the TPP, and that affected Chile, Peru, and Mexico, and renegotiations of NAFTA should begin later this year. Our key positions in the State Department and the White House, National Security Advisor for Latin America, remain unfilled. So we don't know who's he going to appoint. He hasn't appointed anyone for a Latin American position just yet. No significant reversal of Obama's Cuba policies. He met with Pedro Pablo Kuczynski in D.C. a couple of weeks ago and had phone conversations with Macri, Bachelet, and others, but little substance. There is some concern about Venezuela, but that's being channeled through the Organization of American States. The OAS Secretary General is pushing for presidential elections, early presidential elections in Venezuela later this year. But the U.S. ambassador to the OAS is a career diplomat appointed by Obama in 2016. So it's not really a Trump policy as much as sort of what remains of the of President Obama's policies. No ambassadors have been appointed to Latin American countries. No one has been named yet to a Latin American country. So all the ambassadors, the career diplomats, have been so far confirmed, and there are a couple of countries without an ambassador yet. Now, and this is key, all politics is local, right? So Trump's ability to influence the new world order and his ability to implement new policies towards Latin America will depend on the success of his domestic policies. And here, you know, this is just really bad timing. We should have done this next week. But the passage of the healthcare reform will determine his likelihood of passing the budget law. Without healthcare, he cannot pass the budget, because for the budget, he needs to lower healthcare spending. So the vote today on healthcare, if it happens, will determine his likelihood of passing a new budget legislation. If he gets trapped on healthcare, he cannot pass the budget. And that's his sort of political problem at this moment. Now, if Obamacare is not repealed, Trump will be damaged goods. He will need to focus on something else, probably the wall. But it doesn't seem that Latin America will become a priority anytime soon. So, after 20 years, the Monroe Doctrine is under strain, but not from the outside, but from the U.S. from within. So it's not that Russia or China or other countries are threatening the Monroe Doctrine. It is now that the U.S. seems to want to abandon the Monroe Doctrine for lack of interest. So no influence, rather, let's build a wall. Let's separate the U.S. from Latin America. That's producing a power vacuum in Latin America. But Latin American countries at this moment lack leadership. So there is a power vacuum, and no one is filling that vacuum right now because there is no significant leader in Latin America that can sort of rise to the occasion. Now, power vacuums are always filled. We just don't know how that power vacuum will be filled in the coming months. So I will end there. Thank you very much.